Hello everyone and welcome to my review of the final film of the Dark Knight trilogy, which is The Dark Knight Rises. Let's talk about the film, shall we? So the story takes place 8 years after the events of the previous film, where we are introduced to Bane, played by Tom Hardy, who not only escapes from the CIA, but also takes a nuclear physicist and plans on heading to Gotham City as well. We then cut to Wayne Manor, where we are told that the city took action after Harvey Dent's death by passing laws he wanted to put in place, including the Dent Act, which basically eliminated organized crime, where we are introduced to Selina Kyle, played by Anne Hathaway, who disguised herself as one of Bruce Wayne's maids in order to steal his fingerprints, as well as his mother's pearls. We are also introduced to Bruce Wayne, played again by Christian Bale, who has been crippled since the fall that killed Two-Face, where Selina Kyle escapes with his pearls, as well as gets Bruce Wayne's fingerprints. Eventually, we not only discover Bane is in the Gotham sewers, but he also gets the truth about Harvey Dent, where Commissioner Gordon barely escapes with his life. We then see John Blake, played by Joseph Gordon-Levitt, who tells Bruce Wayne that Commissioner Gordon is in the hospital, and that Gordon says the Batman must come back, where Bruce Wayne sees a doctor who explains the vast injuries he has sustained through his constant fighting, ranging from no cartilage in one of his legs, scar tissue, the list goes on. We are then reintroduced to Lucius Fox, played by Morgan Freeman, who not only mentions the fusion reactor that Bruce Wayne funded for a source of clean energy that Miranda Tate, played by Marion Cotillard, backed, but he also introduced Bruce to something he calls the Bat. While Bruce plans on putting on the bat suit for the first time in 8 years, Alfred tells him the rumors surrounding Bane, where he supposedly escaped from a pit prison, and when he got out, he was trained by Bruce's mentor, Ra's al Ghul, and was a member of the League of Shadows when he was excommunicated by Ra's al Ghul. Eventually, Bane breaks into the Gotham Stock Exchange, where Batman returns, but Bane escapes with all the stock of Wayne Enterprises, resulting in Bruce Wayne being broke, all while Catwoman was looking for something called the Clean Slate, where she gets saved by Batman. Bruce Wayne tells Selina Kyle that Batman wants to meet her, and if she leads him to Bane, then he would give her the Clean Slate. Which she does lead him to Bane, but she basically traps him so he fights Bane, and Bane would not only eventually break Batman's back, but also steal the tech Batman has in the Applied Science Division, and places him in the pit prison where he tells him his plan on letting Gotham destroy itself from the inside out, and continue what Ra's al Ghul started. As the film progresses, Bane not only traps most of the Gotham City police underground, but also plans on using the fusion reactor by making it into a megaton neutron bomb with the blast radius of 6 miles and one of the citizens has the detonator to it. Now we are to question, how can Bruce Wayne get out of the pit prison and save Gotham? Who has the detonator to the bomb? Lastly, how can Batman stop Bane? That's all the plot I'll mention, so now it's time for me to say what I liked about The Dark Knight Rises, what I did not like about The Dark Knight Rises, some trivia, my overall opinion on the film. Okay, so what did I like about The Dark Knight Rises? The acting is overall very good. Christian Bale, once again, I thought he was very good as Bruce Wayne and or Batman. While I will mention his character arc when I talk about story, I thought he made that arc very believable, and I felt he nailed with what they were trying to convey, with one scene I thought was acted well, was after he had his spine pushed back into place, and he sees a hallucination of Ra's al Ghul telling him there's more than one way to immortality. Plus, I felt he had very good chemistry with Michael Caine and Anne Hathaway. Tom Hardy, while at times was a little hard to understand, I thought was very menacing and memorable as Bane. Sure, I don't think he was quite as good or as memorable as Heath Ledger's Joker, but that was an unbelievably tough act to follow, and I feel he came close, and what makes it all the more impressive is that most of his face is covered by a mask. One scene in particular I thought he was good was when he was revealing to the people of Gotham that this piece they have was all built on a lie by Harvey Dent and Commissioner Gordon, their two biggest heroes, because the expressions he had with just his eyes was really good. It's just whenever he was on screen, I was glued because not only was I able to take him seriously, but also I felt he was a good villain for different reasons than Heath Ledger's Joker. The Joker I thought was scary because he was more of a psychological threat, where Bane was not only a physical, but also a moral threat with what happened as the movie went by. Lastly, I know some people said they couldn't take Tom Hardy's portrayal of Bane seriously, which all I have to say to that is, watch the Bane from Batman and Robin, that version you can't take seriously at all. I just felt like Tom Hardy made Bane a memorable villain. I really liked Anne Hathaway's Selina Kyle, also known as Catwoman. She definitely nailed the seductiveness of the character, but unlike Michelle Pfeiffer's portrayal, she never went too far with that and she felt more like a real person, and I felt she had wonderful chemistry with Christian Bale, because I felt the interaction were written very well. I personally felt she was the best portrayal of Catwoman to date. While I don't have a lot to say about Michael Caine's performance as Alfred Pennyworth, I will say I felt he gave this movie heart, with a great example being when he says he's leaving Wayne Manor, and just the chemistry he had with Christian Bale made it all the more believable. There are other people in mention, like Morgan Freeman as Lucius Fox, Gary Oldman as Commissioner Gordon, Marion Cotillard as Miranda Tate, also known as Talia al Ghul, and even Joseph Gordon-Levitt as John Blake, but really, aside from saying they were overall great, I really don't have a lot left I can say about the rest of the acting. The special effects are amazing, and I'm still shocked as to why this didn't get, at the very least, an Academy Award nomination for Best Visual Effects. I felt the CGI and practical effects were done really well, with one noticeable example being the bat. I felt that was done rather well, where they had it on a gimbal and through post-production made it look like it's flying, and the execution there was excellent. Another example I thought was well done was the scene where Bane blows up a good chunk of Gotham and it ends with the collapse of the football stadium. Just the way it was done, I thought it was very well done, and I thought it was very well shot. The production value, such as cinematography, art direction, costume design, set design, etc., is very good. One example I thought was not only really well done, but also pretty clever was Catwoman's outfit, which I thought was more sleeker and more practical than Michelle Pfeiffer's costume, and the thing I thought was clever was the way she would lift her glasses thing up, it would take the appearance of cat ears. The cinematography I thought was again excellent, with a few examples being when Bane escapes from the plane, as I mentioned earlier when Bane has a football stadium collapse, and even the fight between Batman and Bane, not just in their first fight, but also their final fight for their survival of Gotham, were all shot really well, because I felt the camera angles really worked, as well as the lighting, like the first fight where they made it look like an arena. Lastly, with the sets, so I don't have a whole lot to say about it, I feel a few examples I think still look impressive even after 2 years since this movie was released are the Pit Prison, Bane's Lair, and the Batcave, with just the way it looked as well as built, I think it's really impressive. The action scenes are a lot of fun and very well done. As I mentioned, I thought the fight scenes between Batman and Bane were well done because of not just how it was shot, but also paced very well, and I also felt the final climax for Batman, Commissioner Gordon, and the Gotham City Police are in an all-out war against Bane to not only figure out who holds the detonator, but also to, of course, stop Bane was awesome because it was so well edited and or paced. I felt the stakes were ridiculously high, which both made me excited to see what would happen next, but it also made me care to see if the protagonist would come out alive. And the ending twist of Miranda Tate being Talia al Ghul I thought was pulled off really well. The music by Hans Zimmer I think is epic. And while I don't think it's quite as good as the score from The Dark Knight, I feel it still gives it a run for its money as the orchestra was excellent. Not only does it get me pumped for what happens on screen, but I feel it's perfectly timed. One example I feel always got me pumped was whenever Bane showed up on screen as the chant I feel made it epic and made me excited for what would happen next. As for perfectly timed, one example I thought was done extremely well was when Bruce actually escapes from the pit prison and the tension builds and builds, and to me made it all the more exciting when he does get out. Lastly, I felt they used piano very well for Catwoman's theme. I just love the score for all three films overall because I feel it fit perfectly with the tone of the Dark Knight trilogy. The directing by Christopher Nolan is very good. I felt he made the interaction like with Bruce Wayne and Selina Kyle very believable, not just because of the acting, but because I feel it was done well with what they were trying to convey. I also felt he did build up really well, with a good example being when Batman returns for the first time in 8 years, where the lights go out and then come back on, and then you see him riding on the Batpod as he takes down one of Bane's men. Lastly, I felt it was overall very well paced, and that for a movie that is roughly 2 hours and 45 minutes, I never got an impression because it was so well edited, with a good example being when Bane tells Bruce Wayne his plan of destroying Gotham. Just the way it was acted, shot, and with what they were showing, I thought it was edited and directed very well. And I not only give Christopher Nolan, but also film editor Lee Smith major praise for that. Lastly, the overall story, even though there are a few things that bug me that I'll bring up later in the cons, I thought was still engaging with some really deep and clever writing. One example I thought was clever was the villain's motivations. Sure, part of it was revenge for Ra's al Ghul, but Bane's main motivation was to show the people of Gotham that their peace was all built on a lie, and Talia's motivation was to carry on the work of her father, much like how Bruce was carrying on the work of his father. And I thought that is actually deep and really clever, and I felt they made it rather clear what their goals were. Plus, throughout not just this film, but the entire Nolan trilogy, Bruce Wayne goes through an arc. If we were going by just this film, Bruce is out of action for 8 years, partly due to Rachel's death and his motion got the best of him, and the other half is he felt the city didn't need Batman anymore, trying to come back, failing and having his back broken in the process, watching the city he loves being destroyed before his very eyes, and learning how to rise up and fight evil again. And I felt they did that arc extremely well. Now, if we were going by the entire Nolan trilogy, the first one was the beginning or the coming of age of Batman. The second film was not only his ongoing fight, but also him coming to the realization of what he must become to save the city, that in this movie to be dragged in the dirt even more because he let his emotions get the best of him, and Bruce learned to rise up and be where he should have been had he not let his emotions get in the way. And I feel this is why I feel Christian Bale's Batman has the best character development over any other actors who portrayed Batman before him. Plus, as a conclusion, I felt it was very satisfying because it tied up the major loose ends rather well, and I liked how the consequences of the previous film was one of the major driving forces of the film. I just really liked the overall story because not only did it have deep and clever writing, but I also felt like it has quite a few great ideas. So what were some of the things I did not like about The Dark Knight Rises? Well, I do have two complaints, one that is pretty minor, and one that's a little more major. And while they do bug me a bit, I was able to forgive them because I feel the pros far outweighed the cons. My minor complaint is it felt like they had a few times where they just did a bunch of quick fixes, such as a doctor tells Bruce Wayne all the injuries he has sustained through his years of constant fighting, including no cartilage on one of his legs, and it's fixed by a knee brace thing that was extremely painful to put on. Maybe it's just me, but I wish they could have done a way where he could move his leg again a bit better, but this, I feel, is a nitpick. My more major complaint is I feel the movie had a few too many suspension of disbelief, and I know you could argue that it's a comic book movie, but given the Nolan films were more grounded in reality, I feel it went too far. Two examples are how could Batman be able to walk on the ice with, like, what, 200 pounds of armor when yahoos in business suits fall through shortly after walking on it? The second one, wanted to consider a plot hole, is how was Bruce able to show up on Gotham considering he had no money and the area was surrounded by not just the army who were more or less forced to keep everyone in Gotham, as well as Bane's men. I know you could argue he might know ways into the city that Bane wouldn't know about, and I might have bought that if Bruce was going from one point in the United States to another, but he was going from one side of the planet to the other, and I felt like that was pushing my suspension of disbelief a little too far because the Nolan Batman films, again, were more grounded in reality than the other Batman films that were made. Like I said though, while these two complaints did bug me, they weren't enough to ruin my enjoyment of the film. Now for some trivia. Believe it or not, The Dark Knight Rises is the second live-action Batman film from 1989 to 2012 to not be nominated for any Academy Award, with the only other film being Batman and Robin, though it was on AFI's Best Films of 2012. From what I gathered, apparently other actresses that were auditioning for the role of Catwoman included Jessica Biel, Ava Green, and even Keira Knightley, plus I heard Natalie Portman was considered for the role. On top of that, Anne Hathaway said this was her most physically demanding role. If anyone's curious as to why they redubbed Bane's voice, that was because when they released the prologue during the IMAX premiere of Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol, there were several complaints that they couldn't understand what Bane was saying, so they redubbed it to make it easier to understand what he was saying. This is the only Nolan Batman film to not be filmed in Chicago, as it was mostly filmed in Pittsburgh, because according to an interview with Emma Thomas, they wanted to emphasize Gotham's size and scope as they shot every inch of Chicago. Plus, if that wasn't enough, they used Heinz Field as the home for Gotham's football team, the Gotham Rogues, and even some of the players of the Pittsburgh Steelers played the football players, including quarterback Ben Roethlisberger, safety Troy Polamalu, now retired NFL player Heinz Ward, and even the former mayor of Pittsburgh was in it as a kicker. Sadly, the premiere of Dark Knight Rises was tragic as in a theater in Aurora, Colorado, a man named James Holmes opened fire, killing 12 people, and around 70 people were injured, and because of this, the premiere in France was canceled, and Warner Brothers didn't release the box office numbers until the following Monday out of respect. Apparently, some of the cast and crew, including Christian Bale, Gary Oldman, Joseph Gordon-Levitt, Anne Hathaway, and even Christopher Nolan all visited the survivors days later. As far as I know, James Holmes' trial will begin in December of this year. Some of the other roles that cast includes Christian Bale, who also played Patrick Bateman from the 2000 film adaptation of American Psycho, Trevor Resnick from The Machinist, the English dub voice of Hal from Hayao Miyazaki's 2004 Academy Award-nominated film adaptation of Hal's movie Castle, Alfred Borden from the 2006 film adaptation of The Prestige, Dickie Eklund from The Fighter, where he won the Academy Award for Best Supporting Actor, Melvin Purvis from Public Enemies, Irvin Rosenfeld from American Hustle, where he was nominated for the Academy Award for Best Actor, and yes, he was even John Connor from Terminator Salvation, Gary Oldman, who also played Sirius Black from the Harry Potter film franchise, Lee Harvey Oswald from JFK, Count Dracula from the Academy Award-winning film adaptation of Bram Stoker's Dracula, Lord Shen from Kung Fu Panda 2, Mason Verger from Hannibal, George Smiley from the 2011 Academy Award-nominated film adaptation of Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy, where he was nominated for the Academy Award for Best Actor, Dr. Dennett Norton from the 2014 remake of RoboCop, Dreyfus from Dawn of the Planet of the Apes, and yes, he was even Ruber from Quest for Camelot, Michael Caine, who you might know as Alfie Elkins from Alfie, where he was nominated for the Academy Award for Best Actor, Milo Tyndall from Sleuth, where he was again nominated for the Academy Award for Best Actor, Elliot from Hannah and Her Sisters, where he won the Academy Award for Best Supporting Actor, Thomas Fowler from The Quiet America, where he was nominated for the Academy Award for Best Actor, Professor Stephen Miles from the Academy Award-winning film Inception, and yes, he was even Hokey Newcomb from Jaws the Revenge, Anne Hathaway, who you might know as Kim Bachman from Rachel Getting Married, where she was nominated for the Academy Award for Best Actress, the voice of Jewel from the Academy Award-nominated film Real and its sequel Real 2, Fantine from the 2012 film adaptation of Les Miserables, where she won the Academy Award for Best Supporting Actress, the White Queen from Tim Burton's Alice in Wonderland, and yes, she was even Emma Allen from Bride Wars. Lastly, we have Tom Hardy, who also played Eames from Inception, Tommy Realdon from Warrior, Forrest Bondurant from Lawless, Ivan Locke from, well, Locke. He will play Mad Max in the upcoming film Mad Max Fury Road, and yes, he was even Theo in the Sci-Fi Channel original movie Minotaur. Overall, The Dark Knight Rises is not quite as good as The Dark Knight. Having said that, I feel it came close and is a very satisfying way to conclude the Christopher Nolan Batman trilogy. The acting was very good, with praise going to Christian Bale, Anne Hathaway, Tom Hardy, and Michael Caine. The action scenes were done very well. The production value was excellent. The score was epic. It was very well directed. And the overall story, even though I feel they went a bit too far with suspension of disbelief, was very good with some really great ideas and clever writing. Now, if anyone asks me, do I recommend this film? My answer is an enthusiastic yes. Sure, it sometimes went a bit too far with suspension of disbelief, but I feel the pros far outweigh the cons, and just overall, I feel The Dark Knight Rises was a very satisfying way to conclude the Dark Knight trilogy, and personally, it's my second favorite live-action Batman film. I give The Dark Knight Rises 4 stars out of 4, and a 9 out of 10. So that's my review of The Dark Knight Rises. If you want to express your opinion on the film, you are more than welcome to, but I ask you to please be mature about it. Any bashing and or personal attacks on anyone will never be tolerated, as it will be removed on the spot and will result in a block, and believe me people, that is the absolute last thing I want to do. So that's my review of not just The Dark Knight Rises, but also my reviews of the Dark Knight trilogy and my reviews of the Batman films from 1989 to 2012. I hope you have enjoyed them as much as I enjoyed making them. And I hope you all have a wonderful day. And not only that, but till next time, as I not only have a few special videos planned, but I will also tackle another major film franchise that began in 2008.